Parents make many decisions that have lasting economic consequences for their children. Where should they go to school? What courses and activities should they pursue? These and other decisions can shape children's long-term outcomes, and this paper examines parental decision-making in one key arena: competitiveness. How do parents decide how much competition their children should be exposed to? The motivation for studying this choice is twofold. First, competitiveness has been linked to educational and labor market outcomes, which suggests these decisions may have important long-term consequences. Second, research has consistently shown that girls are less willing to compete than boys. To the extent this affects later outcomes, we may wonder whether parents reinforce or reduce these gender gaps when they make the decisions. To explore these questions, the authors conducted two large-scale field experiments in Norway. The first involved 740 students from 15 different schools, while the second involved their parents. Children were 15 years old at the time and were asked to participate in a numerical exercise that could be performed under a non-competitive or competitive incentive scheme. Either they received 5 Norwegian kroner per correct answer, or they received 15 kroner per correct answer, but only if they outperformed a randomly selected opponent from another school. Crucially, parents were asked to choose the incentive scheme for their child. This figure shows the timeline. On the day of the experiment, and after their child left for school, parents received a text linking to the parent experiment. There, they received a description of the numerical task and were asked to choose an incentive scheme for their child. Parents were asked not to tell their child about their involvement in the experiment, and were informed that their child would only be told the chosen pay scheme, not that had been chosen by their parent. Later the same day, children participated in their experiment at school. Each child performed the numerical task 3 times. In round 1, they independently chose the incentive scheme they wanted. In round 2, they were assigned their parents' chosen scheme. And in round 3, all children were subject to the same scheme to provide a common measure of performance. Importantly, both parents and children were told that their competitiveness choice would be kept anonymous from the other party, and neither was aware that the other would be making a choice as well. So, what do the results show? Consistent with previous research, there is a large and significant gender difference when children make their own choice. 34% of boys choose to compete, while only 19% of girls do, and a similar pattern emerges when parents make the choice for their children. Parents are 28% more likely to choose competition for a son than for a daughter, and this gap persists even after accounting for risk preferences and parents' beliefs about their child's probability of winning the competition. And while the aggregate patterns are similar, parents' choices often diverge from those of their child. In 32% of cases, the parent and child choose differently. To understand these patterns, the authors elicited parents' beliefs about whether their child would choose to compete, as well as their own preferences for competing themselves. This allows them to model parents' choices as a trade-off between two factors: their desire to maximize their child's utility, and their desire to impose their own preferences. This figure shows that the former has a substantial gender component. Parents of sons are much more likely to believe their child will choose to compete. In fact, comparing these beliefs to children's actual choices shows that parents overstate the gender gap in competitiveness. This pushes toward a widening of the gap when parents, rather than children, make the decisions. But there is a counterbalancing effect. Parents of sons are only marginally more competitive than parents of daughters, both on average are more competitive than their children, and parents appear to weight their own preferences more heavily when making choices for daughters. These effects work in the direction of parents pushing daughters to compete more than they otherwise might, and contribute to reducing the gender gap in parents' choices. Do these experimental decisions relate to real-world scenarios? If the choices made here reflect parents' willingness to put their children in competitive environments, they may be predictive of important outcomes. The authors link their experimental data to administrative records from Norway's National Register and track whether the children in their study, who are in their last year of middle school, go on to pursue an academic or vocational track in high school. Academic tracks are more prestigious, lead directly to higher education, and are considered more competitive. They find that children whose parents chose the competitive scheme for them are more likely to pursue an academic track in high school. Parents' competitiveness choices are more important than children's competitiveness choices, and the effect persists after controlling for parents' background characteristics and even the child's 10th grade GPA. Estimates suggest that a parent's competitiveness choice for their child may be as important as a one standard deviation change in GPA when it comes to predicting their future education choices. Thus, these findings reinforce the view that parental decisions indelibly shape children's human capital development, and in this context, those decisions reinforce rather than reduce gender differences. On this point, note that Norway is generally considered a success story when it comes to gender equity. This suggests that the patterns found here may be even starker in settings with more traditional gender roles. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. This includes research on competitiveness, the impact of parents on children, and gender differences in education and the labor market.